We take it for granted these days that doctors know what lies under our skin. But that anatomical knowledge ultimately had to come from human bodies. Bodies that once belonged to live people. And that presents a unique dilemma in the history of medicine. Early on, physicians, scientists, and even artists learned that the best way to learn about the body is to cut one open to learn about the structures within. They wrote down what they observed and passed these ancient texts down through the generations, slowly gathering new information and educating physicians for centuries. And then for some reason, about 1800 years ago, they stopped. As quickly as it was born, human dissection died a swift death. Now, my brain thinks in terms of stories, and if that were the ending of a story, I'd be extremely frustrated. So I had two main questions. Number one, what was the context for the start of dissection? Multiple cultures in the ancient world had some kind of medical practice, so what was their dissection culture like back then? And number two, what was the story around the time period when they stopped dissecting? I know the Catholic Church was involved, but was it as simple as the Pope making a decree in the Vatican and it changes the course of history? Today, we're learning how dissection became a thing. So we need to get one thing clear right off the bat. What do I mean by dissection? Different historians have different definitions, but for the purposes of this video, it's any post-mortem opening and examining of a corpse, whatever the motivation for its undertaking. That motivation might be to study the body's internal anatomy or for autopsy, dissecting to find the cause of death of the corpse. And this distinction is important because we've been cutting into alive people for way longer. Like, we have records of ancient healers back in the Paleolithic period drilling holes into people's skulls as a way of driving out demons, a process called trepanation. So surgeons performed surgery, but they did it for the sake of healing. Dissection then is more about observation and learning. So to figure out where dissection as a science started, we'll begin our story with a tour of the ancient anatomy labs, starting 5,000 years ago in Egypt. Ancient Egyptians had a much different view of anatomy than we do today. They didn't usually do autopsies to determine cause of death and wouldn't have done any dissections for science either. They did get some practice with some of the earliest surgeries, and they did, famously, embalm some of their dead. This involved removing the cadaver's internal organs to preserve them as long as possible, but at the very most, they would have made small, superficial incisions and didn't glean any useful anatomical knowledge from them. But that did start a tradition of death acceptance and got them skilled with medical instruments. Over in ancient China, their model of anatomy was more concerned with the flow of qi around the body, what they saw as the life force of the universe. And like the Egyptians, they wouldn't have dissected either for spiritual reasons. Like Confucius wrote in the filial classic, "Our body with skin and hair comes from our parents. We must not mutilate it." But when we get to ancient India, we finally start to see some of the first human dissections. To see how, historians look at Ayurveda, the ancient Indian system of healing, or the system of extending lifespan by some translations. Ayur for medicine, Veda for collection of knowledge. And one book within Ayurveda does document human dissection. Sometime in the 6th century BCE, someone wrote a book called the Susruta Samhita. Susruta himself was a physician surgeon who lived much earlier, maybe around 1000 BCE, but that's still out, and he documented a systematic method for preparation and dissection of a human cadaver. That systematic word is important. It shows that he treated dissection as a science rather than a curious hobby. And through this systematic dissection, Susruta described hundreds of bones, muscles, ligaments, and joints. Interestingly, he overestimated the number of bones in the human skeleton. Some historians think that's because he dissected children's corpses and counted unfused bones as separate bones. Now, ancient India had laws against dissection too, specifically against cutting open corpses with knives. Anyone who died over the age of 2 had to be cremated in whatever condition the body was found in at death. Susruta bypassed those laws by wrapping a corpse in long grass or hemp, soaking it in steam or water for about a week until the body had putrefied, then using a special broom-like tool to peel away the skin and muscles and see the structures underneath. Now, neither the Susruta Samhita nor the other books in the Ayurveda say that they ever dissected animals, which gives us the idea that they got most of their anatomical knowledge from humans. All right, but what about the rest of Asia and Africa and the American continent? I had that exact question and looked into the research for mentions of dissection from indigenous American or African traditions, but couldn't find any. Their medical customs were more centered around faith healing and medicinal plants. That doesn't mean they definitely didn't dissect, but it's hard to say without records. On the other hand, the ancient Greeks were very good at documenting anatomy. And they get a lot of the credit for it. But here's the thing, they weren't into human dissection either. Well, Most of them anyway. Starting around 500 BCE, Alcmaeon of Croton used animal dissection to discover how sensory organs like the eyes, ears, and nose had channels leading back to the brain, which is how we understand some of the cranial nerves today. He also noted that arteries were different from veins. He never said how they were different, but they are different. Trust him. He's a doctor. Fast forward to Hippocrates, the father of medicine, and he didn't dissect human corpses either. Maybe he'd take a peek at the occasional trauma victim, but he preferred animal dissection. Part of that was because of how he viewed anatomy itself. He subscribed to something called the humoral theory, which said that disease came from an imbalance in the four humors of the body: blood, phlegm, black bile, and yellow bile. That is a whole separate video, though. Regardless, he and his students still gave us good anatomical observations from animal dissections, like that the heart was red, had a pyramid shape, and had intrinsic electrical activity. But they claimed that it sat between the lungs to cool it off, because the humoral theory also had like a temperature component to it, so in their system of medicine, it made sense. A few years later, Aristotle approached anatomy from the same school of thought. He and his students dissected hundreds of animals, but never humans. Now, toward the end of Aristotle's career, a nearby scholar named Praxagoras got this idea, without ever dissecting a human, by the way, that veins carried blood and arteries transported pneuma, or air. Now, obviously that's incorrect, but he mentored a young boy named Herophilus who would go on to fix his teacher's errors and make an enormous impact in the practice of dissection. It's tempting to imagine Herophilus as a dude obsessed with gore and dissection, but he wasn't. He was a pretty normal physician that was just in the right place at the right time. He was born in 335 BCE and started his career in Kos under Praxagoras, then moved to Alexandria where he spent the rest of his life. And when he arrived, Alexandria was just begging to become a hotspot of dissection. The local leaders wanted Alexandria to be known as a city of science and literature. It already had the biggest library in the world, including loads of anatomy textbooks, and the medical school that Herophilus studied at actively encouraged experimentation, including human dissection. So he and his younger contemporary, Eristratus, would get paid by royals to perform dissections, which kept those two physicians very busy. So for a window of 30 to 40 years, they dissected people in public for the advancement of science and for the reputation of Alexandria. And by people, it was mostly criminals. You'll notice that theme a lot in this series. So what did they learn? Well, a lot about the cardiovascular system. Like, they saw that the arteries were filled with blood, not with air, and they were able to see the pulse in individual arteries along with the heartbeat. They also pointed out that nerves start from the brain and the spinal cord, not the heart, that the heart isn't involved in taking a breath, and they observed the lymphatic vessels. Eristratus did a bunch of really cool stuff on his own, too. Like, he described the epiglottis in the throat and the atrioventricular valves for the first time, and came up with the name tricuspid valve, which we still use today. He also described how arteries kept on dividing and branching out until they got really, really tiny, or what we call capillaries today. Unfortunately, these two were accused by their peers of vivisection, dissection while their human subject was still alive, which may be why we hear a lot about Hippocrates and Galen, but not Herophilus. It may have been legal in Alexandria, but most of the academic world outside of the city didn't support it. Eventually, the rules that permitted dissection were canceled, which marked the beginning of the end of human dissection for a long time. And part of that was because of a competing school of thought called empiricism, which was gaining steam in Greece. They thought dissection didn't have any scientific value, and that you could do medicine through non-invasive observation and experience. The other factor was one popular physician who put out an enormous body of work that scholars and physicians and students would worship for the next millennia. It's hard to overstate just how much of a superstar Claudius Galen was back then. He had a cool opportunity, because he was a physician surgeon for gladiators, and these athletes presented to him with all kinds of lacerations and gore, so by performing surgery, he couldn't help but to get exposure to human anatomy. He eventually became so popular and so sought out that he served as Marcus Aurelius's personal doctor. But he also did a ton of medical research in Rome. Some historians say that his total body of work was between 5 and 10 million words, and about 3 million of them still remain today. For reference, the 7 Harry Potter books have a little over 1 million words combined. Galen and other ancient Romans compiled all of this knowledge without dissecting humans. Sure, surgery on gladiators was one thing, but any kind of scientific insight they got from that was by chance, not systematic dissection. They did far more dissections on animals, especially pigs, to get all kinds of good observations, like that the brain controlled the nervous system, what the kidneys do for urine production, and the difference between oxygenated arterial blood and deoxygenated venous blood. But pigs aren't people, so a few of his claims about anatomy were ultimately wrong.
We'll get into those later in the series.
Regardless, his work was so popular and so complete, and scholars held his work in such high regard both at the time and for over 1,000 years. Plus, the whole human dissection being a legal thing put Galen in a position where he wouldn't be questioned. Now, I feel like when people tell this story, they make it sound like Galen's work was so good that nobody questioned it for hundreds of years. But the story is more complex than that. After Galen, we see this shift where knowledge was supposed to be derived from faith, and the dominating rule of the Catholic Church enforced dissection as illegal in Europe. So it's not that Galen put out the end-all, be-all anatomy book. His work was just in the right place at the right time not to be questioned. Well, until late medieval times, anyway.